Nadabrahma meditation was designed by Osho. Osho is an Indian guru who passed away, I believe it was 1990. However, he sort of attracted a lot of Westerners to India and has a huge following still to this day around the world. Usually in every country there's Osho centers or Osho meditations taking place. So it's quite a group of people. There's at the Osho Ashram, or it's called the Meditation Resort now. I've been there quite a few times, so I know a lot of the old folks there who were there in the days of when Osho was really, you know, attracting masses from the States and Europe and everywhere else. And Sufi Sayam and Krishna, these are people who have been there for 40 years. And so the stories that they tell about, you know, everything that took place and happened and the manifestations that were taking place through the meditations and darshans and stuff, it's pretty remarkable. So, you know, they're Sufi Sam, you've seen pictures of him, right, Trace? He's 85 now,
yeah.
And he just had his birthday a few days ago. So,
you
last
were
couple
last
of years,
year, right?
Last couple of years, I've
yeah.
been able to celebrate it with him, but I wasn't there this year. But he's been in and out of the hospital with heart challenges, so
yeah.
I'm hoping he's going to hang in there
and
I can get back with him this year. So anyways, this particular meditation, Nadabrahma, it's really a beautiful meditation because it involves some humming. Actually, it involves a half an hour of humming. Now, there is no particular rhythm to this humming that you do. In some of the Buddhist meditations I've done, you have to hit a certain note, you have to try to have it a certain way. Not in this meditation. It's just simply for the act, for the practice of humming. So you can change the tone, you can change the rhythm. The main thing is not, you know, to get into a self-conscious sort of, you know, I don't want anybody to hear me humming, you know, just let it out, because the whole idea of it is the vibration of the humming is actually loosening up the internal energy. Okay, so lips stay closed, you just breathe in. You can pace it, you can change the rhythm, whatever you want to do, but that's what you're going to do for half an hour.
The only problem I had with the humming, when we did it in Italy last year, is that I would try to hold the hum a long time,
yeah,
and then I'd have to take two or three breaths. You know, like, you just need that oxygen, so you don't want to try to do that.
No.
Right?
No, you don't want to make it uncomfortable for yourself that you're gasping, so, you know, just hum, and when you get to the natural sort of end of it, start again and hum again, okay? The idea of this is to get to a point where you're not thinking about it, where you're actually not doing the humming anymore. The humming is just doing itself, and you're a witness of the humming. So that's the actual state that you want to get to, is you start out doing the humming. And then afterwards, you're just humming, and you're kind of witnessing this humming just kind of taking place. It's just happening. And you're there, look at that. Okay? So that's why it's a half hour, so you have enough time to work through that stage. Okay. So once you get past the point of the technicality of how do I hum, how does this work, you know, which probably takes about 5 minutes for most people. Okay, this is how I hum. Then let go and just hum. Now the next part is 7.5 minutes, and it's where we're going to use the hands. Okay. And what we're going to do is we're going to start out and we're going to bring the hands in a circle. Now, Osho says move them very, very slow so that they're hardly moving at all. Okay. Personally, when I do the meditation, I resonate when it moves a little bit faster. Not fast, but there's just a little bit more speed to it. Something like this. Now, after 7.5 minutes, we're going to change, we're going to flip the hands, and we're going to go the opposite way and bring the energy into us. So the first 7.5 minutes, we're extending the energy, okay, out from us and out to the universe in a circular, two circles. And on the next part of this, you're collecting the energy and bringing it into. Okay, so you can go as slow as you want, where the hands are barely moving, which is what Osho suggests, or you can, you know, pick it up a pace if you feel like it. It's up to you. Of course, Osho does recommend that it's very slow, though. The next 15 minutes of the meditation, which is the last 15 minutes, is basically observation. So you're just going to observe what has taken place, what, you know, what's happening after you've done those couple of components before the observation stage, and just notice whatever you notice. You're not looking for anything in particular. You're not looking to see if you're enlightened, or you know, you're not looking to see if you're more peaceful, or you know, what your body. You're just observing whatever is there, whatever is taking place, whatever might be. Just observe it and notice what you might notice. Okay, any questions? Okay, so I'm going to set up the music for this now, and then we're going to start. So you have about a couple of minutes anyways, if you need to use the washroom or you need to grab a drink of water or anything like that. And then once we start, it'll be for the full hour. So the eyes are closed on this phase, and just allow yourself to begin humming whenever you wish to start, and just allow it to progress naturally for you. Thank you.
Thank you.
gently come out, and then circle motion back. Nice and slow. Eyes are closed. Sooner or later, the hands will move all by themselves and you'll be witnessing. Thank you. circles. Collect the energy and allow the motion to happen all by itself. Just be a witness. Okay, sitting or lying down, eyes closed, and observe. come back.
No.
Anybody like to share comments about any parts of the meditation or the meditation as a whole?
So much. I felt the humming was a symbol for finding my voice and getting things off my chest.
Thank you.
Actually, I found the humming sort of moved from my palate into my upper chest somehow or another.
Almost you did all of these different frequencies and you found one that just sort of resonated with you. And that's the one. That's the one you melted into.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I found the humming was a good way to calm down and you know, try to break the monkey the monkey noises, and thoughts still kept coming in, but it was just like a monotone, you know.
Right.
I found it, it's a very powerful meditation, but, you know, I guess I always got lost with the giving the energy and then taking it back in, because there's so much more to bring in and so little to give out, because you're just, maybe I just felt like I'm just one person trying to give out. How much can you give? And then, but there's an abundance out there. I thought it was powerful.
Awesome, thank you.
Yeah, when we were taking in, I felt the rocks. And all of a sudden, that was the first time I ever thought of rocks. And then I started taking in, I knew there was one right there. I didn't see you put it there, but I felt there was one over there.
Awesome.
Over there.
I found it too.
Awesome. I forgot about the rocks.
It's okay, Frank. They didn't forget about you.
Okay. They don't discriminate.
When I was bringing in, though, I felt like a healing energy coming. I was trying to touch my body where I thought I might need the energy.
Yeah.
You know, that was a really good healing energy, directing it to where you think it might, you know, do some.
Yeah. Absolutely. Fantastic. Okay, well, I'll tell you, my friend Sufi Sam went to the... He was a CIA agent in the United States. That was his career.
No wonder he ran to India.
he was an interrogator for the CIA for people coming over from the Berlin Wall, from the east side. And that was his job for many years, and it wasn't a very nice job, I'll tell you. Then he got out of the CIA and he became a CEO of a company. And he said all he did was to try to forget about what he did in the CIA was party, party, party. Drugs, alcohol, smoked, everything, you know, did everything. And then he had a heart attack at a young age, at a very young age, he had a heart attack. This is going back over 30 years ago, 40 years, you know. And he went to the doctor, and the doctor says, okay, Sam, you got to start slowing down. Like, you know, you can't keep going at the pace you're going. Didn't listen. Kept going at the pace he was going. Mm-hmm. Had another one. Okay. Right? Slowed down a little bit. Not entirely. And eventually, I don't know what time span, but he had another one. Ended up back in the hospital, and the doctor basically told him, go home, get your affairs in order. If you make it for 6 months, I'll be very surprised. Mm-hmm. So he quit drinking, he quit smoking, you know, he started eating better, and started meditating for the first time in his life. Ended up somehow in India, on the beach of Goa, and met some sannyasins from the Osho ashram. Had no intention of going there, he was just traveling India and, you know, taking different meditations and stuff. And he ended up, he said, I'll go for 3 days and then I'll move on, right? And what started out as 3 days ended up as over 30 years. And, he was in the hospital a little bit there, but other than that, for a 6 month sentence on his life, when he was, I think, in his late 30s or something, you know, and basically told, you've got 6 months, and get your affairs in order, go home and get your will and everything done. He was teaching, when I first went to Osho Ashram 13, 14 years ago, he was teaching a number of meditations to hundreds of people that were there, and, very active, and even to this day, at 85, he's still very active. And I think what happened was he was flying between Romania to Thailand, between India, and he was in the some of the altitude affected, because other than that, he's in great shape.
How did he get the name Sufi Sand? Is that mean?
He taught a lot of the Sufi meditations, like the whirling meditations at the Osho Ashram, and that name kind of...
What does Sufi mean? Does it mean Sufi?
Well, the whirling meditation comes from a branch called the Sufis.
Branch of
which,
what?
Oh, Muslim. It's actually esoteric Muslim branch.
It's a Muslim? Okay. Okay.
And they believe that you can have a direct experience with the divine through whirling. And continuing to whirl and whirl and whirl around in a circle.
We did
one of those meditations at the larger meditation. Mm-hmm. I guess we don't really have the room for it in here.
No.
But the idea of that is that when you whirl long enough and around and around and around, you get an idea that, you know, nothing really is as it is, because everything that you see you can't grasp with your eyes after a while. Mm-hmm. So it just dissipates. And what you're left with is the very center of who you are in that whirling exercise, because that's what keeps you centered, and that's where you whirl from, and everything else just kind of dissolves. So he would teach that, and Osho, of course, devised a number of meditations that had whirling in it, no dimensions, and the longer whirling, which we haven't done yet, but I've done a number of times. One day, hopefully, I'll rent out a bigger space and we'll do the 45-minute whirling.
Dizzy and fall down.
Actually, you'd be surprised.
It's true. You
do in the beginning, but when you let go and you surrender to it, you don't anymore. You become the center.
Yeah.
And I had a number of people at the meditation I did at the high school or at the community center say, I can't do this. There's no way I can turn around and around and around, because I'm going to get dizzy. I'm going to, you know, chuck my lunch or whatever. And I was surprised, because they said, wow, I couldn't believe how, you know, after a few minutes, I was the world. It just came so naturally, and I was at peace. And I could go on and on and on and on and on. And that's what I found when I first did it, too. I thought, no, there's no way I'm going to be able to continue doing this. You know, I'm going to fall over. But you just find your center. And there's not really, some people like to spin really fast, but it's not necessary. You just get into your own rhythm, and you just keep going.
My first way of getting high.
Yeah. Naturally.
Okay. Sneaky Sam's going to talk to you.
All right, so go ahead and take a break, and I'm going to set up for the next meditation, and then we'll begin the Dalai Lama meditation.